I had to describe the Lakers, I would say you take a great talented team and you take great bench strength and you have add a little one of the greatest centers ever to play basketball and you add a little touch of magic. They really are a group of stars without the negative ego aspect.
You know, ever since I was a kid, I've always dreamed about playing in an NBA championship series. I mean, can you believe it? Magic brings the ball up the court. Passes into Kareem at the center. He sees Wilkes. Wilkes sees Gould under the basket. He goes around Bird, over Parrott, and out and in. Yes!
Well, I can dream, can't I?
The rest of it.
Channel 2 presents a salute to the world champion with your host, Jim Hill, and Jim's special guest, Lakers head coach, Pat Riley. A salute to the world champions is sponsored in part by Nissan Datsun dealers of Southern California and by AM/PM Mini Markets. You want it, we got it.
For 25 years, the Los Angeles Lakers have been trying to prove something to themselves, that they can beat the Boston Celtics to win the NBA championship. Eight times they tried, eight times they failed. But on Sunday afternoon in that aging old hothouse called the Boston Garden, the quest was over. The dream was a reality. And to a man, the Lakers stood on that legendary parquet floor, looked up and laughed at the ghost in the rafters that had taunted them all these years. The end of the 1985 NBA Championship Series brought the victory to the Lakers. But at the beginning, the 25-year-old nightmare, it looked like it would continue. It was a Boston blowout from the start, and the Lakers' running game is missing on all 12 cylinders. At the other end of the court, it's Danny Ainge with a lay-in. Magic Johnson tries to keep the Lakers close. He feeds Byron Scott for the great slam dunk, then hits on the bank shot, and the Lakers are down by 12. It becomes clear in the early part of the second period that the Celtics are in command. Kareem has trouble getting back on defense, leading to easy buckets by Robert Parrish. And even when the Lakers are back on D, it doesn't make much difference, as the Celtics just can't miss. Scott Wettman comes off the bench to spearhead the attack, hitting 11 out of 11 from the field. Wettman's three straight three-pointers in the second period just part of a Boston tidal wave that has the Lakers bewildered, and the Celtics are in the mood to celebrate, Boston leading by 30 points at halftime. In the third period, the Celtics don't cool off. Larry Bird from three-point country makes it look very easy. And the Lakers' defense is nowhere to be found, Bird getting loose on the backdoor play all afternoon long. By then, the frustration of the day begins to set in. Ainge tries to retaliate after an elbow by Scott, and Magic and Ainge get into it. The Celtics save their biggest blows for the game, Bird with a brilliant pass to Kevin McHale. And the Lakers know this one is out of reach. LA is left to stand and watch as the Celtics set championship records for most points in a half and a game, and even the number one Laker fan gets caught up in Celtic fever. The Lakers lose the opener 148-114. The Lakers set the tone for the game right from the beginning, feeding Kareem and getting him into the flow of the offense. Los Angeles also crashes the boards. Kareem with 17 rebounds, keying the Laker fast break. Worthy from Magic for a vintage drive to the hoop. The Celtics seem a step slow while the Lakers put their best foot forward. It's Worthy with the animated rebound. The LA fast break, 3-on-3. Nevertheless, Magic blows by Bird for the backhanded lay-in. Off the bench comes Michael Cooper to provide the extra spark needed from three-point country. The Lakers' defense much improved over game one. Watch as they swarm over Bird off his miss. Magic runs his troops back the other way, whipping a beautiful pass to Mitch Kupchak, and the Lakers lead by 18 at halftime. Third quarter, and the Lakers spread the court on the Celtics, working the ball to Kareem, who slams it in the face of Kevin McHale. But by now, Bird has found his range, and the Celtics chip the Lakers' lead down to 12 points at the end of the third quarter. Bird pours in 20 second-half points as the Lakers' lead dwindles to just 4 points in the closing minutes. But in the final seconds, the Celtics collapse around Kareem. He dishes out to Cooper, who puts the finishing touches on the Laker victory, 109-102. What an amazing turnaround for the Los Angeles Lakers. After two games, the best of seven series is all tied at one victory each. With us now is head coach Pat Riley. And coach, you know, so many people are wondering, what in the world did you do to get your team turned around from losing by 34 points one day to winning by seven 2 days later?
You know, Jim, there's always something somewhere that will stimulate athletes to another level.
We felt that we were very intense in our practices prior to the first game. We thought we had given the players all they needed as far as adjustments go and strategies for the first game at Boston Garden, but there was something missing. Maybe whatever it was came out because of that game, and it was an intensity factor second to none that I saw 5 games after that. I think the meeting the next day was an ultimate truth meeting, and I've had a coach tell me one time, and I'm not a docile man, okay? And on the court, a lot of people see me chewing gum and sitting like this and standing, and but there's a time to show your insanity, and I did.
You made so many changes and adjustments throughout the course of the series, and particularly maybe after that first game, and there was one person for the Boston Celtics who really picked up on your coaching strategy, and he was really, really amazed at it.
I feel they got an excellent basketball coach. His strategy was very good. He made more adjustments throughout the playoffs than I've ever seen any coach make. One game I was able to get down low and double up. The next game he had me outside on a different side. It was just unbelievable the way he was coaching the team. I mean, he put a lot of hours in this playoffs.
Now that's really saying something when the guy that's voted the best player in the league can pick up on what you're doing and knowing how well you can do it.
Well, I'm flattered by that, Jim. I as I was trying to make a point, Larry Bird, like Irvin Johnson, like Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, has all of the adjustments made against them. So the great players always see different defenses. They see different coverages, double teams, more people in. And I think probably he read that very well. And we were changing things up a lot, but I was very flattered by the fact that he acknowledged me.
Well, you deserve all that acknowledgement and a lot more. You know, the contributions of every member on the Lakers is well chronicled, just like Pat Riley. But all year long, the team received support from its unofficial court jester, the ambassador of enthusiasm. He's an LA original. He's called Dancing Barry.
Now, I know there's lots of creatures all around the league. There's the chicken, and there's a gorilla, and there's swamp creatures, and fanatics, and coyotes, but I'm a human being, and I feel that the fans needed somebody to represent them. Because when you go to the games, how many animals do you see buying tickets? Not that many, right? So really, human beings buy the bulk of the tickets. When I first started out, I was that crazy guy dancing. Then I elevated to that I'm a mascot, but I'm not a mascot, I'm a human being, and this year, I'm happy to say that I was awarded an ambassadorship, and I'm now Dancing Barry, the ambassador of enthusiasm. Some guy on my block gives out ambassadorships, and I am now the official ambassador of enthusiasm. Not a mascot, I'm not a crazy guy anymore, I'm a real classy ambassador.
But like the players on the team, Dancing Barry had his own special way of preparing for the big games this season.
This is the Dancing Barry special. It's 2 ice cubes. And it's a combination of a New York egg cream, which is where my accent is from, and the California lifestyle, where I am from. There's the 2 ice cubes, some pineapple juice, a little bit of cream, and now the California ingredient, instead of seltzer, Perrier. Mix it up real good, nice and bubbly, and here goes, the Dancing Barry magic potion. Something's happening. Something's happening. Something's happening. Something's happening. Something's happening. Something's happening. And hopefully when it's all over and we've won the championship, you know, they might say, Dancing Barry, nice help.
Game 3 would prove to be classic Laker basketball, but there was an added dimension to their game now. The Lakers had decided that they were just not going to be pushed around on their home floor. It started off on a gentle note. Kareem skyhook floating through the net, and the Forum crowd loved it from the beginning. Meanwhile, Larry Bird kept trying to regain his form. Bob McAdoo and Kevin McHale exchanged in a big Mac attack over who really had possession. The Lakers' running game was in high gear all night. Dennis Johnson's shot is blocked, and Byron Scott takes it the other way for a slam. Meanwhile, Abdul-Jabbar's skyhook is as deadly as it's ever been. And when Scott Wedman is picked off, James Worthy provides the punctuation on a 136-111 Laker victory. Game four is a struggle with every basket a challenge. The Lakers go inside to Kurt Rambis, and the Lakers lead by four at the quarter. The Celtics come back in the second quarter behind Dennis Johnson, and at halftime, Boston leads by one. Third quarter, the Celtics break out to a five-point lead, beating the Lakers back down court. But only to see the Lakers reel off 10 unanswered points to retake the lead, and through three quarters, Los Angeles leads by two. Fourth quarter, the Lakers are up by seven, but Boston runs off eight straight points, paced by Larry Bird, who plays a one-man game in this stretch. He forces two turnovers and scores 6 points as Boston takes the lead. But neither team can take more than a three-point lead over the last 8 minutes of the game. It's a constant seesaw battle, with Byron Scott's slam giving the Lakers a one-point lead with less than 3 minutes to go. Under a minute to go in the game, it's tied now when Danny Ainge fires up this 20-footer, putting the Celtics up by two. On the Lakers' next possession, Kareem can't hit on the skyhook, but Magic is there for the follow, and the game is tied at 105. But Boston has the last shot. They work the ball into Bird. He gives it off to Johnson, who buries the 20-footer at the buzzer, and the Celtics go wild as they win by two.
Losing at the buzzer like that, Coach, sometimes for some teams can be really deflating, and other teams really just can't bounce back from stuff like that.
Well, we were a little bit debilitated by Dennis Johnson's shot. We felt we should have won game four. We had a 7-point lead with about 8 minutes to go. We were ahead by 3 points inside 2 minutes, and we just did not hit our shots. We had great shots that didn't go down. Danny Ainge hit two shots inside of a minute from 25 feet, and then Dennis Johnson's 20-footer broke our back. But our team was still committed, Jim. They were not going to be deterred. It was 2-2, and we knew we had to go into game five with the strongest attitude that we've ever had as a team.
But the game before that, 136-111, when you just, you know, a lot of people really say, well, the Lakers only play finesse kind of basketball. But you really did make a statement then, because that was really one of the first times that people took notice that you were finesse as well as a power basketball.
Well, I think it started after the massacre on Memorial Day. Our meeting and what we had talked about, we made a commitment and a contract that we were not going to get beat just playing Laker basketball. And I think if we went and approached the Celtics in game two in Boston Garden without a physical presence, that we were going to be in trouble. That carried over to the home game in the Forum, and Kurt Rambis and Mitch Kupchak took care of the physical department inside. And there's always a theory about aggressiveness, is that if you're going to hit second, you're too late. And what we hit legally, but we were very aggressive up front.
And all of a sudden, the Celtics are complaining about the roughhouse stuff.
Deception, con, banners, the whole thing. A psych job. I was rather amused by this whole thing here, the rough, tough Boston Celtics all of a sudden talking about another team playing dirty. My comment was to the team, I said, just keep playing that way, because we're playing Boston Celtic basketball anyway.
And it worked out just fine for you. So now, the best of seven series is all tied at two games each. Game five is coming up. If the Lakers lose, they have to go back to Boston and win two straight. So the Lakers knew they really had to win game five. And for them, this was it.
It was a united and charged up Laker team that left the locker room just before game time. And once on the floor, the Lakers exploded, much like they did in game three, with James Worthy scoring 19 of his 33 points in the first half, and Los Angeles led by 13 at the intermission. Second half, and you have to wonder if the Celtics' Casey Jones gets deliberately kicked out of the game in an effort to fire his Boston team up. If he did, it worked for a while, the Celtics reeling off 9 unanswered points, and it's a brand new ball game as Boston is right back in it, down now by 8. But the Lakers snap out of it, going on a 13-4 tear to up their lead to 17 points. But there's no quit in the Celtics. Larry Bird with a rebound, a great reverse lay-in, and the Lakers' lead is a very nervous 4 points. But with under 3 minutes to go comes the Rambis steal, the Magic lay-in, giving the Lakers some breathing room and a 10-point lead. Now Kareem caps off a magnificent 36-point night with one final slam. He scores 4 clutch baskets in the final 4 minutes, and the Lakers win game five, 120-111.
The line, the Los Angeles Lakers will be there.
Yeah.
In Game 6, the Lakers got it going with Kurt Rambis getting the outlet pass to Byron Scott, who banked it in for the first 2 points of the game. The Celtics came right back with Kevin McHale, and the tone was set for the entire first half as the two teams traded baskets. With time running out in the first period, McHale pulled the Celtics ahead by 1 point, only to see Michael Cooper's three-point play give the Lakers a two-point lead at the end of the period. Scott Wedman started the second period off with a long-range jumper, and it was tied once again. At the other end, Kareem takes the feed from Magic, and the Lakers take the lead. But the Celtics matched them basket for basket, and it was getting frustrating. Kareem's skyhook was on target, and the captain would not be denied. Larry Bird continued to try and kindle the fire. Both teams tried to control the tempo, but the score at halftime left both teams fit to be tied. In the third period, they picked up right where they left off. Kareem with the skyhook, McHale from the baseline, James Worthy from the top of the key, then the Lakers surge began. Larry Bird takes it to the hoop and gets the three-point play. But Kareem comes right back, and the Lakers are up by 10. McHale continues his hot shooting, and towards the end of the third period, the Lakers get a real scare when Michael Cooper was fouled by Kevin McHale. Cooper was carried off the floor, and the Lakers carried off a 9-point lead at the end of the third quarter. The fourth period got underway with a bang. Byron Scott and Scott Wedman colliding on the drive. Larry Bird's flashes of brilliance fanned Boston's hopes, but the Lakers were on a mission as they had a date with destiny. And with 5:22 left, McHale, who had a brilliant series for the Celtics, fouled out. He'd have to watch the conclusion, unable to do anything about it. With McHale on the bench, the Lakers began to pull away. History had indeed been rewritten. The seconds on the clock ticked down to the inevitable, as the Lakers were world champions. And perhaps no one savored the moment more than Laker captain Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And it was a fitting tribute that he was named the MVP of the series.
Coach, there are times when you think you can win. There are times when you question if you can win or not. But you really had a good feeling about this particular game, about Game 60.
I had a good feeling about our team, Jim. I felt when we won Game 5 that our motivation was the next game was for the title. And I knew they wanted it so desperately that their whole focus was going back. The other thing was the trip, having to fly all day Saturday. Play Sunday. We've been through that three other times in the finals. Boston had never been through that. We knew we could perform well under those travel conditions. I read a quote in the paper by Larry Bird the next day saying, boy, it's going to be tough for us to travel all day Saturday and get back there and play an afternoon game. I tried to use that as an advantage for our guys, and they felt very comfortable with those conditions. I just sensed that our guys we're ready to play. I felt in the arena there wasn't the same electricity. I also felt that there weren't the peripheral distractions. I didn't see any of the officials that I didn't like to see in a big game. So I just felt things were going our way, but it was still up to the guys. You have those feelings, as you know, as a player and a coach, but I felt it was our day.
So now the championship is yours, and when the championship goes to a team, I'm telling you, it is really party time, and all the honors come in. And we'll be back to show you some of the honors and talk about some of the parties in just a moment. Go to the White House on Monday, a big parade on Tuesday. Under your leadership, the Lakers have won two world championships. This is a big credit to you. You should be able to pat yourself on the back.
Well, I don't know if I can do it right now. I'll try, Jim, but I am just happy as anything.
Yes.
And I think right now all we want to do as a team is to be able to savor the fruits of victory. I mean, what comes with 8 months of hard work and sacrifice by our team are the residual rewards, obviously the money, the recognition. Those are all nice things, but the sweet savoring, basking in the glory for a whole summer. Especially what happened after last year.
Thank you so much. Congratulations, world champions.
Yes.
Let's do it again
next
year.
That sounds good.
That's it.
World champ.
That's our program for tonight. Thank you so much for watching. So long, everybody.